Collection of lectures from Naropa, and of course Anne's memoir, Bard Kinetic. And then I also just want to let you know that this coming weekend, the Poetry Project is very honored to be hosting Triple Canopy's first annual symposium, which will be a series of presentations and talks and performances and readings here. I think that's the news from us that I have to share at the moment, and so now I'm going to turn things over with much gratitude to Jennifer Firestone, who will be introducing LaTasha N. Nevada Diggs.
Hello. Thank you, Kyle. There you are, LaTasha. Okay, it is really an honor to introduce LaTasha N. Nevada Diggs. The first time I encountered LaTasha Diggs' work was in the early 2000s. It was not on the page, but through her own performance. At the time, it was clear I was witnessing an artist whose rich, resonant vocal registers and intonations, along with the layering and scratching of music, sound, film, and image, were cued toward rifts and riffs which understood deeply the notion of collaboration, of being in conversation with what surrounds you. When Belladonna Collaborative published Twerk in 2013, I found that it was through repeatedly teaching Twerk that my reading habits reconfigured, expanded. Each page of Twerk reinvented itself among different rules, play, and experimentation. There is an electric fusion of languages and cultures and a keen and critical eye and ear that critiqued, complicated, winked, rejoiced, and signaled. This was a poetics of permission and an athletic endurance to include whatever was in the stream, plants, animals, litter, pop culture, food, it was all there. In LaTasha Diggs' latest, the extraordinary book, Village, published by Coffee House Press in February, Diggs brings her technical prowess, her precise attention to sound and language, and her intervention of the visual landscape of the page to ask us to think about origin stories, grief, legacy, memorialization. This is not an easy book. There is no digestible portrait of family and history. Pain and trauma never manifest down one track. From the beginning of the book, we're asked to carefully hold the ideas of mothers, mothering. Digg writes in the poem, "Tending to Drunk Mothers," "As is gentle, as with all chosen mamas, aunties, nanas, the nurturing observed with kin, not kin, likely kin, but always kindred." This honoring and recognition of mothering is paired with the reality of the limits of such care when impacted by oppressive forces as poverty and discrimination. Digg later writes, "What the mother's historic struggles for a place free of her previous life challenges most is our imagining of what is impossible without resources within a stable, safe, and sober village." During the pandemic, stripped of some of our pretenses, I feel a hunger for this kind of truth saying, not in a reductive way, not sugared with a shiny moralistic tone or bow tie. There is not one inroad to talk about origin. One's story is also our elder stories and their elder stories and all the communities they lived in. The word village not only calls up home, place, infrastructure, where you live, what's over your head, but also the real people who populate the place. In this collection, Diggs calls up Harlem and elsewhere and the many people from the past and present who are the village. I think of the Gwendolyn Brooke poem, Paul Robeson. We are each other's harvest. We are each other's business. We are each other's magnitude and bond. Please welcome LaTasha N. Nevada Diggs.
Howdy. Good evening. Oh boy. Thank you so much, Jennifer, for this introduction. Jennifer was one of very few eyes that I even trusted to see, because I was scared, just scared to share it. And a lot, I'm trying to pull my eyeglass paper thing out, but it's just like, damn it. But anyway, this baby took a minute. This baby took 10 years to nurture, to abandon, to run away from, to ask for forgiveness, to curse out. And I'm glad he or she is here. So let's get into this, which I had already planned, tending to drunk mothers. As is gentle, as with all chosen mamas, aunties, nanas, the nurturing observe with kin, not kin, likely kin, but always kindred, don't steal from the gumball machine. Offer instructions with a now, baby. Don't raise your voice. Raise your arm to support her weight. Tender, always tender toward pitch of excitement. Hear how you pick up the phone as kin expect, except you should, you will eventually anticipate the situation, caring for your future version. Near fledgling, never near adult, the upward down obliged to depend, soon accountable, soon owe to who birthed you, to them, for her, their service, all those years. A type of mothering, not mothering, a worrying. Did she teach you how to fly, though? Child ain't no does it, does not want to be accountable, don't want, don't know, don't say, tenderly. Nor delightfully, that she can't, will fail at it. Why surprised? What have you offered your youth inside this charm box so cruel? Sharpen the focus onto who never knew your family. Savor their conversations, trips to Costco, gamma scents, Q-tips dipped in olive oil to clean belly buttons. Let them talk calamine and Vicks, collagen gummies. Suckle onto that necessity's nag and atrophy. Care to take sweet care. You're honest about new rituals. What she can but won't say she did, didn't. Don't choke over what she didn't do. She tried and tired of doing. Attrition for the pickled child of a blitz mother, what the blood never taught, what the hand-reared parent thought they taught. Expectations stay unexpected, 'cause shit, they old. Sip till black, black stare, case, she Dipped head, clipped, eyelid, she drips, vomit, grip, more sip, she busted lips, she dribble, she as in drool, she careful, she tiptoe through the number two, she rides as in IRT, each stop a prowler, skips, slides, Komodo, sip good for worms, a choke from Paul Mall's, bits of navy, sweet, scotch, snuff, cradle in gums, zip up to bear down, flapagos, hips, she omit directions in the script, she snip that flabby clip, edit that there Ted bit, she quit more like cold turkey salad, she skipped the training session on how to become a mother. No tips, no blip, no contract with no maternity nurse sign, what CPS got to do with it? Rescript instead biopic onto corn chips for myths. What she ain't fed was fit. Dalonige is chalagi for yellow, as in the color of bile, as in bile from vomiting nothing, as in a trigger, as in a scent so sulfurous, so memorable she'd screech her whimsical enchanted labyrinth in fascist collision with window guards. She considered once a dive out a kitchen window onto the playground of King's Tower. She did dive onto a fire escape once, halted by a pot of Espada G. Sal Giorgi. Knows from The Price is Right how to spin that wheel. Dla Ushta, Yawata Nota, I am not well. Dla oshta, yawa danonta, yawa danonta. I am not well, am not well. Dla oshta, dla oshta, yawa danonta. I am not well. Dla oshta, yawa danonta. I am not well. Ushti is chalagi for baby. Her name is Anastasia, Margie. Her middle name is, after your mother, his name is you, Kiyoshi, her name is, his name is Shaitan, Nami, her name is, his name is Hiroshi, Japanese for generous, her name, Aroha, for love, Lightfoot, her middle name is, after your Ilogi, your aunt, Loki, Loki is hot, his name is Lin, Hopi for flute, a lion's heart, Scandinavian. His middle name is Robert, after your uncle, your Educhi. Mai, her name is Coyote, is Veda for eternal knowledge, Sanskrit, too many foreign films. Ain't feeling Kwanzaa, we won't name her Imani. Yoruba is so cliche. Hush no. Beauty. Mary, her middle name is after your aunt, Uluche. She arrived, she came. Atahua, beautiful. Elizabeth is her middle name. His middle name is Joshua, after your grandfather, after my great-grandfather, Ududu. No one will be named after your father. Dues patir. I willed this. Miss Daisy lived in 2FW. She distilled water by boiling it. She sprinkled ammonia outside her door to ward off evil spirits. My first period took place in her bathroom. Her husband was a Pan-Africanist. He spoke little, sold his Marcus Garvey flags and pins from his green van outside the state building. The last tenant was a chain smoker and filthy cat owner. The real estate agent will only show you should you make 40 times the monthly rent and annual income. Yeah. Zillow feels so lonely. HOA fees are depressing. Aged out as in past ripe, the seeds roasted, wish it would each month. Truth, those words make facts sting. Has your period stopped? Crease in midriff reminds her of the last lyric, I wield my moon, spare her lord of hereditary titties, non-status titties, the apps only serves to monitor the moods. Turn off the Jeffrey Osborne and the Joan Osborne. She pours down the bowl, no future from her diva cup. Otito won't carry the shakers ever. I willed every tadpole to die. Lima Bean ain't a neck named for her own, won't name the nut hatch or her pothos. Somewhere in there, a possibility was R2. She wish it would each month, now wishes Dali Shiba Inu, call me Kitsune. Bless she a sesame, imagine for a second she envies propagating, coulda woulda. This sure ain't antebellum. Oh, what a sad purchase she would have been. Perhaps her genes ain't hardy. I willed this. Perhaps every month when blood leaks, the lining cries, nah, 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 not again, not again. Vitiver root hangs on doorknob. Had I willed, Mistero wanders in thought. A co-op has rules. Last winter here, at least the radiators are whistling. Perry too cold and Menno too hot. This just ain't right, or is it? I willed my cycle to return upon this residential closure. The end of woe is a lie after all. She wish it does each month. Uluche, he named her Uluche, daughter of men. She's arrived, clutching her brute balm. Prenatals are for thinning hair. Thank you. It's like I wrote something here and then it's like, that's not the page. Okay, whatever. Shadiq, or was it Ijo? Topsy thumper, may he trust your tremor and kindly back up. Hand no wrist bone impaled on cheetah mauve comforter. This is a sweet 16 fuck. Brave his mucks, that rancid oil paint he drafts you to spread and freeze shut. Velvet shower curtain, black light bathroom, winching. The neck, no, the back cracks, digging in straddling pressed against the sweaty toilet. Granny canny outside, your every gas distracts. Funyun forecasts, he doing his business. Rats must expel their droppings in that crevice. Roots of frost banged against tile grout. Don't even hiccup, your buds are your buds. Iris a shade of grizzly, maybe we'd make pretty babies. Irritant is your natural sound. Rough roll down, he slams. There is a squeak. What business it is of you? Play deaf, damn it, play dumb. You making him soft. Tremors from all that trap hushing. Try not to disappoint. Maybe heave less. Displace the cooing on edge of bed facing Fifth Avenue. Fearful his mother might hear us. Flash of hand raised to slap at earth, neck bone pinched by a toilet bowl, knocked, then perforated, deltoid, torn, shattered patella, and so on. But that's his future. Easy as in gentle as in worth, the carefree curl home kid, froze shut ruffles, salt and vinegar, 25 cents, a fupa pat with his business. In a panic, the breasts recover quickly to brassiere. So this your first time? Crotchety shit, neighborhood boy shit, dumb shit. You mean messed up, the quiet storm. French kissing should mean something, like a bowl of Werther's, roller coaster and Ferris wheel, double mitts, milk duds. Miss Martha don't remember Mommy's dead. Dream pictures, dream a painting on cardboard. Dream youth, how the older ones don't fade when lost for so long, even her disaster dreamt. Dream conversations with artists. Dream of artists with aneurysms, stunted tall walkie-talkie dreams, sueño impediments. Dream elegant older women in cosmetic jewelry. Dream they keep the pictures. Dream they keep the portraits of the dead. Dream storefronts. Dream theaster and some real shit about property and taxes and developers. Dream a Prada endorsement or a vodka commercial in the guise of intellectual discourses over inclusion in contemporary art. Dream the black mold may avoid you. Dream dementia, seizure dream. Dreamt the artist's deathbed is her bed, is her real bed, is her grown-ass woman bed, is a full-size bed, ain't even a queen. Dreamt next time a California king, if in the same household, this time you save him. Dreamt a man on Lexington dream. Dreamt Lux cherries, trees from Haiti. Dream she found pictures of Mommy as a girl. Dreamt decades ago. Dream she wasn't that bad a visual artist. Dream tags and cardboard, more cardboard. Pangarap, a demolition. Allez, the dead almond sapling. Sonier in the rain. Soaked kicks, the labyrinth dreaming. Dreams balding, dreaded men. Dream an open heart surgery. Dream you died, she died. Dream Spotify commercials. Later she survived. Dream dreamt the mother's fibroid on CT scan. Dreamt the scar down her chest. The scar paraded dream. Dreams, dream floaters, agititi, dream plaster and drywall come tumbling down. Dream no one remembers these transom shadows. Dream somewhere else, elsewhere, anywhere, not here. Yes. A proposal for the Mayoral Advisory Commission on City Art, Monuments, and Markers. I will create a monument to celebrate Cowboy and Billy's legacy and other neighborhood heroin addicts who served as foster parents. I will celebrate them as functional enough to monitor their addictions when tending to my little sister and me on and beyond 111th Street. This monument will celebrate trips to the movies on 42nd Street and comic book readings. It will celebrate how these types of extracurricular activities with Cowboy and Billy, when appropriately supervised, led to imagination, dreams, possibility outside our neighborhood's landscape. Depending upon your vantage point and approach to Lenox Avenue's corner of 111th, the monument will comprise of two silhouettes, Cowboy wearing his military boonie hat and Billy wearing his leather bomber jacket, with one facing east and the other north on the triangular public area that is the beginning of St. Nicholas Avenue, or Wekweskeek, an old Wappinger tribal trail that predates the commissioner's plan of 1811. St. Nicholas, aka Santa Claus, is considered the patron saint of sailors, children, and thieves. The monument will stand directly across from the once iconic red brick building that housed the Yiddish Lenox Theater and the Second Canaan Baptist Church. Rainbow granite will be carved in a shape that mimics swollen forearms with hyperpigmented papules, commonly known as junkie arms, the results of skin popping and long-term intravenous drug use. It is my opinion that Cowboy and Billy disrupt the perception of those with drug addictions. Both are worthy of a monument. This monument showcases how Cowboy and Billy maintained a sense of morality and a protective attitude toward their drinking buddies' children, oftentimes contradicting the public's positioning of them as only heroin addicts. Counter to commonly held perceptions of drug addicts, Cowboy and Billy saw us, the daughters of men, as worthy of a childhood momentarily free of trauma. On the day of the unveiling, I will host a screening of the 1973 James Bond movie, Live and Let Die, as the site for this future monument appears in an overhead shot when Agent 007 ventures to Harlem to locate Dr. Kananga, AKA drug kingpin, Mr. Big, played by the actor Yaphet Kotto. Yaphet Kotto co-starred in the film Alien, 1979. My first colonoscopy. Y'all been there. Soon come. They did not tell her it goes black. Memory, dreams, last word, languages, small talk over allergies, and then a smirk of black, a question about travel, Brazil. She arrives into the peat's gloom. The decomposed ocean flutters, lonely. Here, that descending device, will she tear? Not easy to dish, dis at ease-ish. Or clamp down on the ascension. Slow reference the chemoed colon of the mother. Don't they hear the hassle? Y'all don't love us like your calico bass. To prop mommy on a treadmill for stress tests, post-stroke, singing hypotheses cause surgeon synopsis slept post. A shy evasive for the elderly, protect the white sturgeon at present, but what about the purebred beluga caviar? They don't hear she tight, not hating tight, not weave tight, not money tight, not gene tight, not STD tight, not EBT card tight, not she say, he say, they say, what they say, fuck what they say, fish on tight, fuck them all tight. Said daughter's flight during said routine, a decade long guilt trip, said routine with small but real risk. What they previously said that guilt is something sinful, though valid. Past incident, who's to blame on that vehicular assault? Third, first, fourth, fifth, second resident? Didn't they see the oar fish beached during 2006 tropical storms? Licensed medics too calm about flexible tubes up asses for past tense there some past era. Daughter be mildly torn about getting guts torn. She tight. Off with the costume, just us. Wish this was euphoria. The panic loom attack on sins posthumous with Prozac hails like a whale, Mary. Hail Margie, hail Marguerite, Martha, hail Mahalia. Hail Mary, oh hail Mary, won't you? When you found Jesus near the Black Sea's basin, we roam Margaret's daughter, Tasha's mama. The seismic cha-cha high step deepens moan about to crap the Baroque trauma. Sturdier her intestines. Can't kunta crimp on bowel prep. Bentonite spirituals and South African aloe, cascara, colonics. Sticky okra she might, I eat, or won't she? Bad genes can't gleam elements absent. Is within the human him. Silence is flaxen you and pig-eyed, soaking in a lukewarm chitlin bucket. Come. They told me. Who they? They nothing, no feeling. Nothing heard. Evade reticulated pythons in the Everglades with oaths. Break they water. Us salamanders. Relapse mushroom ramen, run off a white rice spam for Pop-Tarts. Low sodium says Progresso won't go down and run off of Yoplait. Down goes the milk of magnesia. Instant espresso solo, some reflux of chicharron, cuchi-cuchi. What falls out when they collapse? All day down the commode misfits, crap, la scie, le bleu. Death ain't nothing but a fiber optic, a catheter, matrium et filia. Absent now, as is, they was, is, as, apart, marred, the gash guts crippled, is the liquor spawned. And like mother, the molting larva awakes from that blackening malox murk. Someone's haze high on warm wood. Don't you pull me up so quickly. I may get the bends. Hour of the star. The time is 1 p.m. Was born alive. The time is 8:44 a.m. The mother can read and write. The time is 7:32 p.m. The father is unknown. The time is 5:21 p.m. The infant has been given eye drops at the time of birth. The time is 12:37 a.m. The mother's race is colored. The time is 4:49 a.m. The name for the child will be decided by a nurse as the mother is high on twilight, as the mother's grandfather died in a sanatorium somewhere near PD. The time is 7:49 a.m. The name for the child will be decided by a nurse as the mother was under the influence of alcohol at the time of her arrival, as the mother thought the child to be a boy. The time is 5:38 p.m. The mother's residence is unknown. The time is 4:22 p.m. The mother's occupation is field hand. The time is 6:14 a.m. The child is alive. Continued. What kind of impact, artistic, intellectual, communal, civic, social, etc., do you hope your project will have? 200 words. As of present, there are no public artworks, specifically monuments, celebrating Harlem's Black and Latinx community. Thus, in conversation with other public art projects, Uluche has created throughout Harlem, Uluche wishes to honor the nameless, representing saviors and teachers to a pocket of youth, often the black sheep or oddballs, who were without functional family units. It is Uluche's desire to uplift those who were not public figures, yet were involved in affirming publicly, and to ask questions about whose social standing actually matters. A point of inspiration for this monument is by the sculptor John Roden. Commissioned in 1974 by Harlem Hospital, the sculpture, Untitled Family, can be seen in the 1990 film Morbetta Blues, and is a site for many Harlem bus tours and participating black churches. Uluche's proposed monument expands Roden's black family unit to include the chosen family, whose very presence contributed to Uluche's understanding of black and brown lives. By employing a non-traditional sculpture to depict non-conforming identities, the monument serves to highlight the fortitude of not only Cowboy and Billy, but also the many outsider-insider people they represent. This is ultimately about the visibility of everyone in Harlem's village. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, LaTasha. It was a torrential, thrilling reading. And we're going to take a break to re-atomize. Maybe like 5 to 7 minutes, and then we'll come back, and I will introduce Anne Waldman. Thank you again to LaTasha and to Jennifer for a beautiful introduction.
Great reading, wow. Beautiful intro, beautiful.
Thank you. I really
Okay, is this on? Yeah. We're gonna resume very shortly. Shortly now. Like right now. I spoke to so many people during that break who said, I'm so glad I'm here. Yeah, and I felt that very deeply after that reading. So thank you again to LaTasha for reminding us that we are here. I didn't write a terribly biographical introduction for Anne Waldman, partly because this most recent book is a memoir of a kind, and I think that the life facts should be revealed to you through Anne's reading. But I will of course say that in addition to being an amazing poet and teacher and mentor and activist and editor and anthologist, Anne is a former director of the Poetry Project and really an architect of this project. And as I've been spending time with this book of hers and thinking about this reading, I've really been remembering the spring of 2020 when I spent a lot of time alone in this church rereading a very specific poem of Anne's, which is called St. Mark's Church in the Bowery. And it was written on the occasion of the burning of the church's roof in 1978. And the poem begins, I am carrying hidden progress, interrupted by sobs, deeply under a flood of light. It's been such a several years period of many deep sobs and the reminder that we are carrying hidden progress also propels me. So now I'll get into my introduction proper. One of my favorite refrains running through Anne Waldman's inspiring, totally original memoir, Bard Kinetic, is this phrase, how to. There's a fulcrum in here that feels so true to Anne's poetics, infrastructural, tentacular, I'm borrowing her words here, rhizomatic, trickster. The work flickers with a recognition of multiple channels. Also a sense of responsibility and devotion to the task. The importance of deliberate decision. Don't hang too long in equivocation. How to? We have work to do, and Anne is such a poet of the rolled up sleeve, so let's be specific about what the dirt and our manners of digging will be. Why the depths? Especially in Anne's hands, the language is as much a question as imperative. How to? Question mark. Questions are the methods which become also materials of change, circulatory kindling for group action, response, and regeneration. Her composition of lyric and epic come, I think, from a deep integration of social practice, of participation in many visions and versions of world. Anne's poetry reflects and nourishes new kinds of utopian endeavor. The characters, mythologies, grammatic structures, etymologies which sprawl across her work have planetary gravity, they manifest orbit, cosmic balance, and a deep regard for what on the horizon is unfathomable in these or any lifetimes. I have never known such a thoroughly Zen doer. But, of course, Anne Waldman is our quintessential Aries poet. She heralds spring and zodiacal youth. She intuitively draws us together and forward. Wonderfully, her birthday once again approaches. The air grows warm with happening. But I also remember reading Anne's work that what we perceive as new and emergent is also just one surface on a rounder and more ancient dial, a germinal source which has persisted through a very giant night. It is amazing to be with you here in the future of the church door she walked through. She brought the future with her everywhere she went and remembered, and she continues indefatigably to chart the course and room. There is so much audacity in her project, our project, and she reminds us this is a living word, a verb, project, that where we are is what we do. I'll close with her writing on this place where we're gathered. Quote, some of the story will never be told. Held in magical interstices in secret mind computer chambers deeper in heart's tender spaces. How many times could you fall in love? How many times could you have your heart broken, reading after reading, event after event? I bow under the task of this description. Suffice to say, it was and continues to be, as of this writing, a holy place for poetry, and continues to be a project in the sense of an outward projecting, to direct one's voice to be heard clearly at a distance. What a distance this book and work and life is. Please join me in welcoming Anne Waldman to the Poetry Project.
Thank you so much, Kyle. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Thank you, LaTasha, for a very beautiful reading. And thinking back to when I met you coming to Naropa in 2001, right? I think so. 2002? I don't know. With Akila present, and that beautiful, auspicious gathering, coincidence, whatever, meeting you and hearing you tonight is so special. We're all airy. Okay, this book, thank you to some of the folk who helped me, Zoe, wonderful, Ed Bowes, Alistair, Julian, my neighbors, all the friends here that go so far back in my life. I think I walked through the door in, 63 or 4 for some open reading. And, it just went on from there, door after door after door. So I'm going to jump right into the section called Sketch. And this goes to about, maybe the beginning of or some of the writing of the Eovis trilogy, Colors in the Mechanism of Concealment, which was a 20-year project, really. And also my son's, right after my son's birth, and sort of him coming to some of the things that I was grounded in and so on. So there's a whole second part to the sketch, but I'm going to jump in on sort of getting out of college. I'm going to open also with this quote from Laurie Anderson, based on a Wittgenstein, Walter Benjamin. So I'll just read it. I'm not going to give a lot of footnotes. She said, "What is history?" And he said, "History is an angel being blown backwards into the future." He said, "History is a pile of debris, and the angel wants to go back and fix things to repair the things that have been broken. But there is a storm blowing from paradise, and the storm keeps blowing the angel backwards into the future." That's a little picture of my granddaughter, Cora by Anaya, who just turned 3. She's on the cusp of Aries. Okay. So here I am. I went back to New York City the first year, taking a number of odd jobs, several in the theater, including work at the Theater Genesis at St. Mark's Church. I again worked at the Shakespeare Festival in Stratford the following summer, and then the subsequent winter, with my mother's support, I was able to take a volunteer job for several months with the American School of Classical Studies in Athens, assisting one of the leading archaeological scholars on the amphoras that held wine and oil. Dr. Virginia Grace was a rare being, and another devotee of classical Greece. There was something mythological in her situation. She had been crippled at a young age by polio, lost a fiancé to early death, remained single, a lame votary, passionate about her discoveries, chained to the temple of Apollo. Her profile, to my eye, bore a striking resemblance to photographs of the seminal writer H.D. She took me under her wing. We often ate lunch together. I sat for hours in the cold stoa of Attalus, surrounded by tiny electric heaters, reading and cataloging the numerous amphoras that had been found during a recent dig around the stoa. They bore striking steel seals that located their places of origin and helped determine ancient trade routes. The shapely amphoras carried wine to and fro from the islands and further off to Africa, to Asia Minor. Dr. Grace had cataloged nearly 1,500 stamps used on these ancient vessels. What remained but the stamps and the phallic handles, the shards of cold runic clay in the hand that held secrets to the Hellenic civilization, its comings and goings by sea. I took a side trip to Egypt by boat, felt my life charge changed. There was the notion from Ezra Pound of make it new. It wasn't anything goes but finding old or neglected texts or voice from other places, your own ancestry, which called to you perhaps to resound with, to make anew, to recover. Buddhist texts had the same effect. I got outside myself by being alone without a restricted sense of self. I was drawn to Greece through my mother's experience. She lived under the wing of her father-in-law, the great Greek poet Angelos Siklianos, from 1929, when she was about 19, to 1939, before the war. So my mother's experience into Egypt, the hieroglyphs, old ritual texts, I had dipped into the Egyptian Book of the Dead. The sun god Ra says in the coffin text, I have created the gods from sweat and the people from the tears of my eyes. I wanted to explore and describe these heightened experiences of attraction, of mystery, talking to other times and places. It wasn't about interpreting them. It was more like mythopoetics. These currents kept going alive in your own psyche. Also, I wanted to be able to condense, crystallize the impressions, wanted to make sense of what I saw, how else to hold it, even briefly. I was on the African continent suddenly. This seemed amazing. Never forget kissing the ground as we embarked in Alexandria. I had been reading the Alexandria Quartet with some fervor. Never forget the night in a rickshaw waylaid by the Ali brothers who wanted to take off my clothes and see a real American girl. And how could I forget camping on the shore and diving for fish, knife in my thick rubber belt, in the Red Sea, whose water was a rich blue, and how forget the kindness of the elegant Copt and his family who worked at the Banaki Museum. They took me to dinner on the Omar Khayyam houseboat restaurant with sumptuous courses of exotic edibles. I remember being extremely embarrassed by a drunken American at a table close by. I pretended I was Canadian, always, on the strips. And the Coptic children in old Cairo throwing stones at me, riding a camel at Giza and crawling on all fours through the narrow passageways of Cheops. Imagine suffocation by sand and the questions everywhere from young Arabs about the murder of President Kennedy. It must have been Lyndon Johnson. I had some questions too. Never forget trying to sleep out in the desert near Luxor under stark bright moon, on alert, terrified of the ubiquitous scorpions, ambushed by a violent strangers. I tried to board the boat heading back up the Nile from the temple at Abu Simbel, and wrenching free the constant female swerve away from peril. I remember thinking, that swerve away from peril. The temple was slated to be moved further inland to avoid flooding caused by the ambitious but ill-conceived Aswan Dam, and I watched it disappear from view from the stern of the boat, a magnificent tribute to a megalomaniacal state of mind. Ramses wanted immortality at all costs. These sacred sites, the pyramids, Thebes, Dendera, Abu Simbel resonated in imagination. They were power spots. I felt curious vibrations. I kept a journal. I wrote a long poem, long since disappeared. This surely was what a writer was meant to do, rediscover, track power spots, travel around the world collecting images and stories, sleep in temples, feel the power of sacral architecture, conjure alien gods, comment on the folly of kings. The lone and level sands stretch far away. And then I go on to defending mythopoetics a little bit, you know, Greek and Egypt and all the people who think they were Egyptian princesses and so on in a former life. And then we go to working with the Heath family in Philadelphia, 64. It was also the time of the so-called Philadelphia riots. Not an accurate word, but so deemed. I live close to some of the action. My cohorts with the community center in a Quaker building were paying attention. We saw some of the wreckage followed the questionable racist behavior of authorities. And various people were working there, in addition to Percy Heath and family, Harvey Brown, student of Charles Olson and poetry editor of Niagara Frontier Review, Frontier Press, and that was the occasion I went to meet the Mongolian Buddhist Lama Geshe Wangyal, who had come to America on a Tolstoy Foundation grant and was residing in a small town, Freewood Acres, New Jersey, in a pink suburban house. I was nervous, knowing little about the protocol for meeting such a formidable personage, and had worn a dress and put on lipstick, which seemed natural enough. A close friend commented on the impropriety of the makeup, but I held my ground. This group from Harvard that included Leary at some point, and Robert Thurman. I held my ground, and I never wore lipstick anyway, but anyway, back then. I held my ground, sensing the conflict that might arise if one became sycophantically inclined toward a teacher, a guru, always trying to please, impress, come as you are, seemed the best motto. I've been reading some of the old stilted translations of prayers and texts emanating from the work with Geshe Rinpoche, mimeographed on a bright, goldenrod colored mimeo paper. So this was my first joy and occasion with mimeo, which became an addiction once we got here to the Poetry Project. In this very room, thousands and thousands of pages were mimeographed and collated and disseminated to the world now. And people collect these things with the little, you know, staple marks that have turned rusty. There's rust, and that's really hot. The rust on the mimeo machines. So then, okay, we go on. Then I travel to California. So I got to go to the Berkeley Poetry Conference, 65. I've talked about taking the vow to poetry, watching Charles Olson come unglued on stage. He'd just taken acid or something the night before. He was coming, driving people from the room. Robert Duncan, can I go to the bathroom? Everybody wanted to take a break. Anyway, that's some of that's documented, but I didn't have to go pee like some of the guys. Ed Dorn and others had to go. Anyway, so yes, that was, I just wanted to be there in that space with poets in the room and talking and having this, I didn't even really understand all the layers or the, was it a King of the Raft scene with Ginsberg and Olson, what was going on exactly? Very few women, and then Spicer was boycotting, and so and so, and you were sort of picking up on all this gossip and cliquishness, and you thought, this is all about a poetry thing, you know, these great battles going on. Anyway, it was so enticing, and better than any, you know, daytime TV thing at the time. So yeah, so that's 65. And there was this tribal, I describe as a tribal exchange taking place. Olson raged and wept more than he read, but a poet coming apart and reintegrating was holding the stage. His friends were dismayed. The sense that one had a personal dance or motion in the world, a job to do, came to me. What sustained this big bear of a man whose feet lifted off the ground as he read, arms supporting his massive frame at the podium? What was it? Poetry. And Robert Duncan's arms waved and danced as the air as he read two gestures into ether. This was a body poetics. I go on about my vow too much, a vow that I would spend my life developing and maintaining such a poetry as poets, part of a compassionate human cadre of like-minded Illuminati and practitioners of the art who could really hear recombinant music in their nervous systems and who were outspoken rebels as well, challenging the status quo and would take the whole ride, as Ted Berrigan would say. And the great thing was, you know, Ted would read his sonnets, and then Robert Duncan would write his own sonnets on the spot and send them to our new magazine that Lewis Warsh and I started, Angel Hair Magazine. So anyway, that wonderful sense of contiguous reality and continuity in the continuum. So, and then I go on about psychedelia expanded the consciousness, as did liberated sexuality. Women could be empowered, more in touch with their bodies as landscapes for writing, not imprisoned by hope and fear of being desirable. Feminine language could stretch to these new parameters. Other cultures, old cultures, were being rediscovered. Minds some of us wanted to see newly, freshly, through prehistory's eyes, the origins. That was what Peter Lamborn Wilson's talked so much of, the origins, back to the origins. Sappho's fragments suddenly, modern poems, ethnopoetics was relevant, more relevant, in fact, than the European canon as it studied songs and rhythms of the indigenous people of his continent. Projective verse, exploratory poetics, duende, personism, continuous present. And then I'm going to skip to... okay, we're going to back to New York, so back... And I had met Frank Gohara the spring after the Berkeley conference, introduced to him by Bill Berkson, who was teaching at the New School. My mother was in Bill's class. Bill was having a party at his bachelor pad on posh 57th Street for his students, which included Bernadette, Anna Wiener, Michael Brownstein, Peter Sheldahl, Lady Patty. Later, Patty was a student, and various accomplished New York School literati. Frank walked in, waltzed in, with the painter, sculptor, and musician Larry Rivers. They seemed metabolic brothers, led by an air of grace, pungent high talk, gossip. Frank was friendly, insisting that upon graduating from college, I should come and work at the Museum of Modern Art as a volunteer, of course. I'd learn lots. And he had started at the bottom. Bill also introduced me to poet and dance critic Edwin Demby, who was to become a close older friend and mentor. Edwin tried to teach me, if anyone could, to stand in front of things, to stop and not keep moving, stand in front of things, to simply stop, stand, look, and trust what came to mind. An odd detail, gesture, obscure angle being marginal, the awkwardness between buildings, people to observe, stopping, looking, follow your own train of thought. And then we go into Frank's tragic death in 1966 at age 40, stunned the art world and much of the poetry world. The New York School was grieving. He was a planet. He was a center of the system, magnetic, stimulating. We were the circling him around the sun. He was still a young poet. Although I'd only just met him, I felt his transmission. I felt when he asked me to come and do this, he was just looking at me. It was like he was seeing something to encourage. And so how to appropriately honor and describe the countless events, readings, performances, first encounters with some of the most controversial and outrageous thinkers and writers of any time, New Year marathons, memorial readings, collaborations, benefits, all-night planning sessions, fundraisers, magazine collations that were to take place under the protective wing of St. Mark's, how to record the imprint in heart and mind stream of language, sheer sound and beauty of vocables as they resounded ear to ear, how to tell, hear the sweetness of Charles Reznikoff, the trajectory of his work, unique, modest, tough, how to capture the menacing hilarity of Gregory Corso streaking at a Michael McClure reading, the symbolic assassination of Kenneth Koch with a blank pistol during the period of Columbia University insurrection, where he was viewed as establishment hierarchy by poetic anarchists who stormed up the aisle at St. Mark's Church right next door and fired a blank pistol. It was scary. I went to the nearest bar and just was so happy that nothing serious had happened. And Kenneth wanted to go on. He wanted to go on. So the symbolic assassination during this period of the insurrection was, was sort of planned by people we knew. I'm not going to name any names. Who would have thought? Who would have thought? Some are our best and brightest. Who would have thought? A blank pistol, yeah. Denise Levertov's sharp, more of this list, sharp political concern during the Vietnam War, yearning and impassioned rage in her voice, clear as a bell. Ken Kesey making the audience stand and really breathe. the rafters shaking with hyperventilation. I mean, when you worked here and you had to be in charge, and there are like 1,000 people in the up on the balcony, which is a very important, amazing history of those slave pews, the early pews. Dance space has done a lot of work around that, as have some of the poets in these kind of investigative, historical, documents that have happened around these things. Anyway, an amazing space, but just have the floor shaking and wondering, you know, we had no protection or any kind of, who to call? When I got to Naropa, it was the same thing. Who do you call when, you know, they're going to storm the battlements? And who did you call back then? Anyway, this is the second oldest Dutch, it was Dutch Reformed Church. We could hear Petrus Stuyvesant, the first, what was he, governor? Governor. Governor. With his peg leg, dragging his chains? Why was he dragging chains?
Peg leg.
He was dragging his peg. But the city.
There,
yeah. And also the times when we'd come out from the Mimeo chaos and in the room upstairs with Pinkerton men showing up with guns, you know, when we tried to trip the tripwire for working in the church office. And there were grave robberies. Right out here, folks, right out here. People looking for the riches of the past. That's why they moved all the great tombstones down, so you can walk on them rather than open them. Okay, sorry, digression. Somebody should really write the definitive book, or we should all write it. Okay, so we went to Ken Kesey making everybody nervous, and really breathing, that's what we were supposed to be doing. John Wiener's fragile and dreamy movie star reading, one pant leg rolled up, gold lame scarf around his head. Amiri Baraka hammering on content, power of his prophetic song. Burroughs's comeback to America with gravelly demonic voice from an even darker side of samsara. Yoko Ono's minute of white silence during the annual New Year's benefit reading. Barbara Guest, elegant, brave, and lucid after a serious concussion. Light streaming in the church's stained glass windows. The morning we began the all-day, all-night Gertrude Stein marathon. Some of the story will never be told, held in magical interstices and secret mind computer chambers, deeper in heart tender spaces. How many times could you fall in love? How many times could you have your heart broken, reading after reading, event after event? I bow under the task of this description. And at the very end here, there's something, a transition. Going to Boulder. I talk about colors and the mechanism of concealment, which is the subtitle for the Jovis trilogy. Invoked in the subtitle of the Jovis Project are the ways colors get deep into the body with their own language. It's a heart movement, my dear friend Peter Warshall has said. We talk about colors as emotions, as music. It's the way we look at anything, feel anything, but they seem to transmute some esoteric knowledge about space, about existence, about communication, how we are kept magically alive by mechanisms we hardly understand, and how they can be manipulated, a kind of illusion. We connect to nature, to beauty, way beyond the human realm, but also deeper, darker nature, the shadows of concealment might be more appropriate. They, the colors, the shadows would be a goad for the lifelong investigation, this mythic record of a rival government through poetry, a system for unraveling, a universe of antidote, a long epic that exists in opposition to our own worst barbarism, zones of cruelty and ignorance. I needed to gather and scribe and compose luminous texts that had the glow of true exile, how hard the human consciousness has worked to get us to where we could be. You want to let that go? I bowed to all fathers, teachers, brothers, husbands, lovers, friends, sons. I won't cancel you, I'll ride you to account. The full title became In the Mechanism of Concealment. As Ambrose, my son, chanted the various ways to cover up plutonium on a long car ride, and I noted them down. Let's cover up plutonium with a graveyard. Let's cover it with one of every single stone in the world, pennies, quarters, everything. Then gold around plutonium, then diamonds, rubies, emeralds, and there's plaster, then linoleum, then congolium. Thus, the child, in an act of spontaneous litany, became the ultimate guide for the poem, how to transmute toxicity in the most extended piece I'd written up to this point, 1990. It was an attempt to catch the vibration or patterned energy of one being on this planet as she collides with all apparent and non-apparent phenomena. And then, the book also has a lot of quotation. It's a real kind of memoir archive and laced with poetry and some talks from this and that, essays, interviews, collaboration. But here's from Spicer. The ocean, humiliating in its disguises, tougher than anything, no one listens to poetry. The ocean does not mean to be listened to, a drop or crash of water, it means nothing. It's bread and butter, it is bread and butter, pepper and salt, the death that young men hope for. Aimlessly, it pounds the shore, white and aimless signals. No one listens to poetry. Well, the point there is that the ocean's not asking us to listen to it. I mean, that's the point. We're not being asked to listen. We'll notice it. So moving along. On the road to the contagious hospital, it breaks me up, last days of Phil Whalen. I can't tell of it very well. In the years of war, of dark age, all the genocide raining down. Who's in charge, Philip would ask. Not I, them, but them is dead. Them is an anachronism. Let me say, Laguna Honda, a hospital? Hospital? No, a state of mind perched high, but down on its luck, better days of lovely, minimally attended gardens take a turn, all variety of cactus. It's like a Tibetan bardo maze flashing on its hens and chickens, those little swirls of rubbery green succulents. And you don't know how to speak to the chickens, let alone the hens. Please, not like that. I was talking to real chickens and hens, not these succulents. As beautiful as they are. Let me say, we, Nick Dorsky and I, first walked into the empty anteroom at the mite as we might cross a magic threshold, the antechamber to death, to the part where you only have your hearing left and someone is reading the Tibetan Book of the Dead, where you fight off flickering projections back to every encounter with our dying Roshi Philip. The time you took his hand, the time he was reading Emily Dickinson, and the space got interrupted by the young man, Tom Savage, in fact, having epileptic fit, pencil swinging madly out of control on the page where he made notes and Philip kept going nonchalant. She, Emily Dickinson could handle that, Philip said later in private. So all these projections arise in the antechamber. I could see Philip, thin and fragile or large and swollen. I could see him with hair and beard, and I could see him enjoying food, Chinese food, his takeout food. What path would he choose in the afterlife? The bright lights of food and pleasure, the dimmer light of ordinary mind, or the most challenging blaze of all, dangerous, come back right away and save mankind. Whoa, mankind, Alan sang. I've been given a gift certificate at Bergdorf's, and John Wiener's wanted it from the start, as there was then a kind of sisterly competition we were playing at, which is what I am thinking now, so let's go up there now. Let's go up there. Okay, he was just visiting and about to give a reading in the gold lame number, a jumper a la Liberace. He's wadding gobs of Kleenex into the bra, and the sales girl is being very attentive, playing along. John wants to try on a range of blouses. I'm a more impulsive shopper. I say, I sort of know the best stuff on from the start. That looks good, but he's not buying it. So we end up with a rather dowdy black thing that doesn't look any better at the apartment back on St. Mark's Place as he's primping in front of the mirror. But that means we can go back tomorrow and find another. That would be best. And it's so much fun to go shopping with John Wiener's, another performance. And then I can't remember what happened, but I think this is all precipitously before he tries to board the airplane to Rome without a passport and ends up again at Wingdale. And one visits the large rooms with mad people in them, and he's very distracted and medicated. Melancholy carries a red sky and our dreams. John Wiener's. Where was Alchemy in 1961? Where was Freddie Herko in 1962 before he walked out the window? And the unguents and libations of velvet life and stammer and conquest and wow, how many arms can one woman have to keep the world afloat and make babies? This bird, my dove, flies backwards and in all 10 directions of space. Laboratories and ruminations of the goddess Suprema inhabit the Hotel Albert. One, a brew of herbal elixirs, good for circulation of the blood. Two, mind of the poet that warms to John D., occultist, astronomer to Elizabeth I, owner of the largest library of that time. Three, if you could mix sulfur and mercury, you would be the perfect bisexual. Four, get on stage and act out a scream to dare the elements of invocation. Five, revolution. Six, the rotundity and science of light and cool shadow. Seven, a place in the country, preferably underground. Eight, live outside the system and forever. Nine, barter on the side. 10, the upside down fool, welcome him, understand him. I wrote some things down for the future to bank upon, to stay the blast. My card said obviate, my sword said rule. My card said a sun in your center, and my card said heartbreak, and I started out early to walk in the New York dawn, her stealthy tarot on my mind. Amid urge caution, we gathered for the poetry festival in Ostia back in the 70s, the place where Fellini filmed all the beach scenes, Edge of Rome, Umpapa bands, marching the sand, the ubiquitous boy-child leader allegorically representing optimism and imagination both. Beautiful chaos set against the ebb and flow of moon, time, water, innocence, impermanence, and flicker of celluloid. The audience had been camping at Ostia 2 days, extremely hungry. They might storm the stage, the organizers warned. They'd been promised rock and roll and food. They were hoping Patti Smith would arrive. We had several strategy meetings where William Burroughs advised, a chair is a weapon, stay your ground. Alan was more conciliatory, remembering the savagery of the cops in Chicago. He wanted to start chanting. The reading began. A somewhat magnetizing young woman came to the microphone and droned on for what seemed an eternity. Story was that she'd been tripping for days, her sense of the whole world watching, and she said something like that about the world watching, and we are all molto bellissimo. Ted Berrigan said we should have in our psyches the voice of Mayakovsky reading to a huge stadium of nudniks. Tension in the summer night. The reading proceeded. Amedi Baraka had urged caution. Amedi was the backbone of our poet's cell. There could be agents provocateurs afoot. Be cool, he said. How would the Carabinari act? We were being paid in lira sotto banco, under the table. Our hosts were anarchist theater folk. Amidi's intensity transformed to a graceful animal proprioception when the crowd rushed the stage. It was surely built for this, like a movie set, and we leapt off. I caught his face, ready, resolute, alert, as in, I've seen this before. The structure collapsed. In survival of the fittest mode, Burroughs had a wooden plank ripped from the stage, raised and ready for defense or attack. And next I'm going to... And this is an early poem, 60-something. It's called Teen Languishing in Cove. The fable of the little girl who liked sunlight, so she pulled down the blinds to keep it all in for herself. Little magazine of poetry, enticing to see, flagrant, flaunts itself, a dress of black taffeta, new norm, what cannot be seen, stitches a symbol, nuclear particle, walk through objects, correlations, or descent to wandering in reading, binary frames, ineffable displacement, a teen body, vagabond, loves girls bounding, little magazine of matchsticks, twigs make vibratory, hold it up all to see, queen's horses, a ride into battle, something like that, disavows taciturn refusal on other side of me, valiant suitor for poetry, this side, this magazine, on this side is lovely, to what agency poetry floats, narrative voices, girls and temperament, gone icy while they await discovery, inimical to me, lovely to read, to see what a storm, someone blind in it, an error of identity blends in it, it bends a comma, futurist people mix up in it, mind and matter, then grammar, you love to meet and pass them, to praise them, to on the road, long time to be found in the mouth, in the mouth more migratory herds than its spring, everyone hungrier, graduating in poetry like temperament, passes in a ghost system, grasses mask urgency, legacy. What to name child of the crossroad? Name her poetry. People continue reading as animals first appear. She lets her vibratory weight fall on brusque poet's intentionality. So he sees, admires, she will steal his fire with proof of herself's gentler valor on the ground. Feminist skin waits to be revealed. What she has chanced in constellation, where else get the repose that poetry knows? But I am older and truly see wild ruses of poetry. And thank you. Dear Bernadette, it snowed last night, dropping many degrees from over 80 to 20s in one plunging night where I have never experienced this neighborhood so still. No howling dogs, no coyote, mad dog owned by former policemen across there, barking restless night behind us. Right there, this guardian lives in the yard, his little red house. I mean to still be sitting at the desk many hours, starting at dawn in trance of zen, snow, silence, doing little. Then a Zoom conversation about the Terigata, old enlightenment poems by women from the time of the Buddha, with the Jaipur Literature Festival, which is being managed on carrier waves from London. Jane Dalrymple Hollow called then in a flurry about covering edibles in her garden and needing to deliver a basket to me, where she did, my art supplies, copies of National Geographic, making a collage for Laird Hunt, something about sunspots. Most everyone careful and stays down the walk. I watch Barbara Loden's Wanda in the middle of the night and have been looking at all your photos in memory again and stills from La Captive, Proust's La Prisonnière by Chantal Ackerman, and 10 inches now on the leaves. Your Ed, I can say this, needs a serious woolen coat. Been reading Sadia Hartman, who will change the way you think about all you know in one round life. Wanted to finally tell you it was I who sent those red roses. Wanted you to think a stranger loved you too. I was that stranger. Oh, lucky stars. And Cedar Saigo had said, when are you going to, you know, write some personal poetry? Practical Thunder for Cedar. And this is based on some old notes with a conversation with Diane De Prima. I remember phone calls to Diane after a breakup. She, like Joanne, would advise that you keep the domicile somehow, that was more important than heartbreak. A domicile was something tangible. Where will you work? Set up your shrine. Living is too expensive. It's not economical. Can't someone live in the closet or in the garage, in a shed? Work it out. Take turns. Don't be privileged about this nightmare of survival, not wise ecology. But the pain, you'd say, the pain of separation. Stay friends, and there would be that. Lovers to brothers, get out from under what burns you about the Kerouac School. Your great view, they'll say it's not a school without a building, an endowment, supposed to get more academic. Don't spend all the time resisting, but of course, all the time resist. Make shape of your own imagining for it, what you would like to envision. If you split with that, a school you make, you think about how they'd have to deal with that. Load you lifted. You're lifting it for them. Let them figure it out. Panic about the archive. Maybe someone could wake up, but maybe not. If you're so damn wide awake, no one will think they have to be too scared to let go. Is there logic in that? Guess so. But I promised Robin Blazer we'd all be in the archive heaven together. And Amity said, don't let them get buried. Don't let them get lost. Don't forget Moonset, the upside down left-hand path of Ulat Bamsi, topsy-turvy. Who's in, who's out? We're all the scandal, never to be an apologist for anyone. Not the godforsaken beats, please. We will have our beat day in court. Her third eye, high concern, out from inside, was checking me out through the wires, maybe feeling a pulse, inside sympathy, how hand pulls hair back out of your eyes. Well, you taught me, wipe your eyes, ease and not worry, not so uptight. Let things unfold of their own volition. Don't push to study every which way of which of the magic arts. Take a symbol, stay with it, a witchy way. Visualize it as it moves through you. They'll come requesting you. The bodhisattvas, I promise, the perfect symbol for you, the perfect yidam and inner deity's secret. I know, I say, these things are symbols of themselves. Get out of New York more often. Don't you miss it when you're, it's always with me. Won't you want to stop? What about Bobby Dylan? Lucky to have seen him play live all those times, whatever the thunder, nice time, nothing to cling to. How can poets live that luxury? Why can't rock and roll do more for the cause? It's some kind of God realm thing. What kind of music is it anyway? I guess for the pleasure God realm, Deva Loco, could you be jealous of the God realm? I'll never be able to define that soft indulgence. And Ginsey, he wasn't even there with you when you met Muhammad Ali backstage at the Garden, backstage having to deliver a spontaneous poem, for he said, so you're a poet and you know it? Intersections for consociational map with his bodyguards and pastels, not more unlikely contenders in the night. Bob was purposely confusing Burroughs with Tennessee Williams, and we were going to meet Raul Castro at a party. Where? And I'd say William, and he'd say Tennessee. I sometimes wanted to get to a monastery. You want to indulge, wait till the seat gets too hot, and then you crash. Get back on stage for idiot wind syndrome, like a stone rolls home in no direction, more like a tambourine scatters. It's the sexy sub-vocal of all the songs when you hear the man talking beyond himself, like Glenn Gould humming with Bach. And just a few more. This is for Ed Bowes. My beloved auteur, Ed, and he has, there's a quote in the book about how he's, more of a dramatist and then a documentarian. Anyway, I can't find that page, but ever his own universe, he does what an Ed does, as today does Eugene Onegin, taking all time, mind stock of editor, film editor Ed, not dandy or cynical, but strange where figure of light and figments of clothing appear as cuffs sheer shimmer or shoulders taut drape or tea gone wild at hip. These are the pictures in this film. What to do but remain geometry's heart on a new season, dist her nape, never her grace, her stare, never lace. No such narrative meaning, emphatically no, for sound, for sense, for the perfect vertical. And Ed says, they're not actors, they're presenters. Go for the figurative, Eugene Onegin. Again, St. Petersburg. Your name, Edward Francis Xavier Bowes, a bow centaur, set up high home or cheekbone to a shot is seething. Your commune, the company of inscripted friends, stop. A prevalet or Sicilianos on windy tundra, Gertrude or Nathaniel Hawthorne's wife and wolf and WCW epistolary, maybe Carolina under a tan and Pethabridge at piano, a teen demands to exit the poet's voices. And Ed says in subvocal, any time now. As actors wait a cue, Sojourner and Ellsworth pause, nuanced in soft Oz, his method, a tribal leap goes. Just call his figures, orientation to sun, a house, and a system's response. Turn a moment here, a moment there, one more take and land the mystery. Night plot, igni involens, as Stephen Taylor champions Judith Butler, system of reality minus message. Uli tends a fox and a seahorse, powder room for daily touch-ups as cells undulate to keep the reel turning, and beauty and memory and Ed's non sequitur arising. I would really like to communicate with you one day on Jupiter. Dust disses a light box's best boy. Wait for me, my darling. In a volume like this, you master subterranean hauteur in a mercantile skeptic's voice, or would assent, cry, refrain, jointure, action, never lonely on this high ground with ideals wed to camera in thy commands. The stage times gone by over horizons, not punching the gut of a star, but sturdy boats and sturdy, sturdy boats, la gloire. Thank you, Ed. And I'm going to close with, where is it? My piece for Kathy. Ugh, corset, where are you? This coffee house, they need a slightly bigger print. Okay, so let me find. I think it's in this is in four sections, and I think this is in the long books. Okay, where is it? It's called Mix Up the Cry of Desire. I'm a corset wrecker, 247. Okay. And then there's one little bit from the Jaguar, 24647. And it starts, in memoriam Kathy Acker. Sometimes I want a corset like to harden me or garnish. I think of this stricture, rain, language, building as a corset, an outer ideal mold. I feel the ideal molding me. The ideal is now my surface, just so very perfect. I know where to buy it, and I take it off. I take it off. Lisa Robertson. What is it? Why is it, Kathy Acker, your Emma Goldman, end of dream? I confess you are a wonderful anarchist. What is it to be corset maker of labor and purpose, binding the bone and rabble and cotton in a daily sweat of anarchist teen toil? I, Emma, I, Anne, I, Kathy, what is it to know the sweat of us, my sisters? Will heaven give in to defiance? Will heaven rock the defiant? May Day, 1886, a deficit. The workers celebrate and demonstrate disobedience. Our concerts, silver daggers, and matter explodes when she, a they, a he, a they, and all a they, and you take off the corset and the rich girls don't dance, enter and disrobe their sweet fucking slits. Slits are voices and vices to crush your wealthy patriarchs. Deconstruct the bone and cloth and taxes that bind and fill up the purses of oligarchs. What is a sexy oligarch? I doubt it. This is Sunday, a day off in the piss factory. I was paranoid. You take my reading away. I don't want to be alone with my machines. Oh, Emma. Oh, Kathy. Oh, Hannah, oh, Carolee, please bring in the stranger who holds the strings he pulls through the aperture of patriarchal factories everywhere. What oligarch wears the corset, inspects the factory, it's piles of rubble. While we're the center of the universe, they speak exploitation, can't help but demean. Are these not the civil magicians? I, timeless, and I, a one, were a ghost of dead sisters. Are we recognized imposters everywhere? I file past the crypt of Uncle Ho. I, an anarchist. I, Emma. I, Kathy. I, Carolee Schneeman. I, Hannah Wiener. I, Anne, fresh in from Russia, where they touch up hideous Stalin. I, with the country in pilgrimage. They call us the American War. How many shrines to author you, Uncle Ho? Constructed jumping identity. I am on pilgrimage. Image war is not real needs. Needs. Death is needs, needs, with your universe, top of body, toys, but image nation, the top of the bloody soil. Kathy sees this ahead of herself while dead, where a court pronounces four anarchists murdered, and Albert Parsons speaks for 8 hours, and I demand the floor. Tiny hands with needles, punting, pushing, slamming, the passion and innuendo in the new American century abolished. It's an all-in epic and all-opening, resounding no, screaming, I am the defendant. Let the words out, abandon cover of the corset constraint. Taunt, taunt, taunt your tiny hands at the machines. Are you needle sewing a distorted body? Are you sewing power, moon against your heart? You want to escape the factory metabolism. Nipples rub against the stone of empire that binds the bone in this labor to you who will always be asking our divinatory cards about future boyfriends, those who no longer kiss the butt of the state and profit off the labor of Emma's hands, and Kathy and Hannah and Judith Molina and Carolee's and I, author Anne, who makes not a dime to dine out, and our girlfriends, may they all be on our side. Workers of daily living, surviving an economic purse-string purpose, what is it to be declared? What is it to be a migrant worker? Emma, her long days in toil, making a garment, while I, a system, want only to let the anarchist in. We help you now, sisters. I toil. Kathy will arise. Anne in safe territory. Did Emma ever take her revolutionary sex, love, lust out of Russia? Where is Russia in heavens? Emma, lament. We are at war, sisters. Kathy, Emma, Melina, Diane De Prima, Anne, Carolee, I, author, America, to be your crucible. In an energy of daily sweat and toil to be free of the fascisms of how and when and why and oh, never free of J. Edgar Hoover. But my Emma, Kathy, Carolee, Hannah, Judith, Diane, imaginations ever free of the imagination of J. Edgar Hoover. It is still he who will surely, most certainly have your number in his fractious labor and psychopathic toil as he toils and plays with John Lennon even now when he, the ghost of fractious fatwa, dead J. Edgar Hoover, is stalking, haunting the workplaces, the meeting places, the commune of all my sweat and purpose. What is it to be a large woman, bespeckled and intent in a socialist moment. You want to call it that? Well, you can call it that, and it's so much more, but do call it that, and you will, I'm sure, call it that, the most dangerous of violence and terror to incite a riot. What is it to be thus trouble and to be forever unpopular with authorities, to be watched and goaded, arrested, locked down? What kind of terror moment is this? And will it survive and assassinate a president, this kind of moment? Will it survive McKinley? Will it survive psychopathic, fractious J. Edgar Hoover? And will the ghosts of Haymarket stalk and tremble this Union Hall? And will Kathy Queen of Pentacles and Carolee and Hannah and Melina de Prima surveil these clusters, these mirrors that fracture empire? I live to see, oh, brave sisters, oh, Emma, still in that old purpose, binding cotton. And will that will that acts and buffers, stabs of protest and memory arising, will it, oh, my sisters, will that break the corset that binds the moment? Thank you. And so I'm going to close with a few lines from the Jaguar Harmonics, Liana Concordance. Okay. Thus, medicine ceremony provides bounce for consciousness, for sublimated, almost sub-vocal hum, for communing with the dead. Medicine is the turtle carapace, the eye of newt. Medicine is epicanthic fold of wily Maya. Medicine is your fortified city. Medicine is your map of skin. Medicine is your lover. Women weave fibers of henequen or hemp into your ritual. Medicine is your twine, your thatched roof. Medicine is inside you, and you will reorder the chemistry. Take this drop, mere prompt to disband what you hold so tight, acquisitive person, acquisitive person. Acquisitive. Medicine is our obsolescence, maybe opalescence, a guest in the house, a mendicant, a servant, an underling. The language for poetry is psychopathic in that it keeps you close to the edge and surface, physical proprioception. You swirl inside the mounds, things do, redo, undo. You write out of purgatory. The intricate interlocking visual patterns go mad with delight. Tongues flicker inside animal heads, multiple arms and tentacles of the tentacular interconnected worlds, visible energy. The animals consume one another. Ugly, proud, forbidding, and scintillating beauty spills over. Never stop, kinetic force field. And you are included strangely. Who is the watcher this time? Who is the watcher within the watcher within the watcher this time? Arise and shed your watcher. Disappear into the earth head first. Oh, kind medicine, why are you even here? Why did you hope? Why did you ever hope? What did you hope being here, aspire to? Person of headdress, of scarification, helmets with descending birds, a dolphin headdress. Mitigate your experience. Listen, here your lunar night, your water night, your earth night. Pacha, mama, bury me in the halo of fire. Wizard night, show me the maleness of ancestry. What do you know of it? The landscape of your own cosmology, the terrain of aspiration you trip and stumble with. All your pores are open in the tantric twilight, shapeshift. Listen to the big cat purr, the harmelotics, Ornette Coleman of essential time, the harmelotics. Stop thinking. When you remember, when you feel pity, when you sit down to read your brain, what are you reading now? What old memory? A range of philosophers come to you at dawn with good advice. They move the day forward a few light years. You feel yourself as the disaster feminist. You dissolve into the fossils of all the demons of your life and time. They still haven't answered your questions. Fossils of your vanishing. You want to be with a poet. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, LaTasha. Thank you. So happy to be here. Thank you.
was looking for you. Are you gone, gone? Call you on the phone. Another dimension where you never returned. Oh, you know what I mean. I was looking for you. Are you gone, gone? Are you gone, gone?